Good morning. Today's topic of discussion is Privy Council. And in this, we are going to discuss earliest appeals to the Privy Council from India. So let's discuss introductory part. English people are known to the world for their bravery and adventurous nature. They were the pioneers of colonization. They were systematic in their approach. They believed that the foundation of good society is always in sound judicial system. As such, wherever they went in the world, they had their settlements, afterwards turning into colonies and ultimately forming part of British Empire. There were about more than 100 colonies worldwide under the British Empire. In order to provide for sound judicial platform, two highest courts were established in England. Firstly, for the cases arising in England, and secondly, cases from outside England. But those cases from those areas forming part of British Empire. So let's discuss the origin and establishment of Privy Council. As every political system develops for itself a certain sort of legislative, executive and judicial machinery for its smooth working and administration. Establishment of Privy Council was with the same objective. The Privy Council was nothing but the judicial body which heard appeals from various courts of the British colonies, including India. So let's discuss the origin of Privy Council. The origin of Privy Council can be traced back to the Norman period of English. The Norman conquest of England was the invasion of the Kingdom of England by William the Conqueror, Duke of Normandy. In the early history of England, the Norman kings ruled over England with the advice of council called Curia Regis. So Curia Regis is a Latin term that means royal council, or that is king's court. This was a supreme federal council of Normans. Curie acted as the agency of Normans to rule England. Through Curie, the whole administration in England was controlled. However, gradually, with the passage of time, out of Curie, two distinct bodies, namely Curia Regis and Magnum Concilium, emerged. Out of them, Magnum Concilium was a larger assembly or a body which was called for consultation on certain occasions and which was to deal with executive matters, whereas Curia Regis, that is King's Court, performs judicial functions. So this small assembly or body of selected important or royal officials were called as Curia Regis. The Curia Regis was a small body consisting of royal officials to assist or to advise the king in the discharge of the various functions, for example, legislative, administrative, and judicial. So their duty was to advise the king in matters of legislation and administration and to deliver a justice. In fact, the Curia Regis acted as a final appellate court for England and English Empire. Gradually, the Curia Regis came to be considered as the advisory body of the king, performing most of the vital functions in the field of judicial administration. Finally, during the regime of Henry II, there was a tremendous increase in the judicial functions of Curia Regis, and it led to the formation of two different common law courts in England. The common law courts to be noted here, the common law courts and the court of chancery of England developed through the smaller meeting of curia regis. The smaller meetings came to be known as council. So curia regis led to the formation of two different common law courts in England, and they were the king in parliament, that is court of house of lords, and second king in council, that is court of privy council. The former, that is king in parliament, became the highest court of appeal for the courts in England, while the latter, that is privy council, acted as the highest court of appeal for all British possessions and settlements beyond the seas. In the course of time, Privy Council originated from the smaller council of the king. In this way, the Privy Council was established during the middle of 16th century. Thus, it acted as the advisory body of the king with regard to the affairs of the state. Headquarter of the Privy Council was at London, and its power were implemented through the means of royal proclamation, orders, instructions, etc. Earlier, the Privy Council, let's discuss the composition of Privy Council. Earlier, Privy Council used to do its work by means of a system of committees and subcommittees. However, the committees did not have permanent existence and membership, and mostly members were the persons with little judicial experience. Naturally, it affected the administration of justice. So, keeping in view the extent and importance of the appellate jurisdiction of Privy Council, in 1828, Lord Brougham pointed out the defect of Privy Council. And he pointed out that the judges were laymen who were hearing appeals. They were laymen. Subsequently, in 1830, he became the Lord Chancellor. And during his regime, the British Parliament enacted the Judicial Committee Act 1833 in order to reform the Constitution of Privy Council. This statutory committee was known as the Judicial Committee of Privy Council. In this way, officially, the Privy Council was created on 14th August 1833 by the Act of the Parliament. The Act empowered the Privy Council to hear appeals from the courts in British colonies as per the provision of the Act. Accordingly, under this Act, the quorum of Judicial Committee or Privy Council was fixed to be 4. It composed of Lord President, Lord Chancellor, and other chancellors holding judicial offices. It was the last court of appeal under the throne. Thereafter, by means of the Appellate Jurisdiction Act, 1908, this membership of the Judicial Committee was extended. It also empowered His Majesty to appoint certain members not exceeding 2. So these were Privy Councillors or Chief Justice or the judges of any High Court in British India. Thus, some of the members of the Privy Council were the persons well versed in Indian laws were appointed in the Judicial Committee of Privy Council. So now let's discuss appeals from courts in India to the Privy Council. So this we are going to discuss under the following subheadings. So early charters and appeals to Privy Council. The earliest appeals to the Privy Council from India were not appeals against the decision of any court, but These were the petitions to the English crown against alleged oppression by the East India Company officials. The earliest appeals from a court in England to the Privy Council was in 1679. The appeal to Privy Council, the provision was made under the Charter of 1726 and 1753. So let's discuss. As far as India is considered, the Privy Council acted as an appellate body since 1726 with the establishment of the Mayor's Court in India. For the first time in the Indian legal history, the Charter of 1726 granted the right to appeal from the courts in India to Privy Council. So, earliest formal provisions for appeals to the Privy Council from courts located in India were provided in the Charter of 1726. The said charter established three mayor's courts at Calcutta, Madras, and Bombay in the port cities. The provision was made as to first appeal from the decisions of Mayor's Court to the Governor in Council in respective provinces, and the second appeal was allowed to Privy Council in England. Whereas the Charter of 1757, which re-established the Mayor's Courts, reaffirmed the said provisions of appeal to the Privy Council from Mayor's Court. The next one was the Regulating Act 1773 and subsequent charters. This act empowered the Crown to issue a charter for establishment of Supreme Court at Calcutta. Thus, the Charter of 1774 was issued by the Crown to establish a Supreme Court at Calcutta, and it abolished the respective Mayor's Court. Section 30 of this charter granted a right to appeal from the judgments of the Supreme Court to Privy Council in civil matters if following two conditions were satisfied. Number one, where the amount involved exceed 1,000 pagodas, and second, where the appeal is filed within 6 months from the date of decision. In the same way, the Act of 1797 replaced the Mayor's Court at Madras and Bombay with the Recorder's Court and provided for direct appeals from these courts to the Privy Council. Thus, the right to appeal from Crown's Court or from King's Court to Privy Council was well recognized under these charters. Appeals from Sadar Diwani Adalat. Besides this, there were company's courts, that is Sadar Diwani Adalat and Sadar Nizamat Adalat. They also recognized the right to appeal to the Privy Council from their decisions. Accordingly, the Act of Settlements 1781 provided for right to appeal from Sadar Diwani Adalat at Calcutta in civil matters. Appeals to Privy Council from High Courts. Under the Indian High Courts Act 1861, the High Courts were established at three provinces. It was the amalgamation of the King's Courts and the Company's Courts. This act provided for the right to appeal from the High Courts to Privy Council from all its judgments except in criminal matters. In addition to this, there was a provision of special leave to appeal in certain cases to be so certified by the High Courts. Then the appeals from Federal Court in India to Privy Council. The Government of India Act 1935 provided for the establishment of the Federal Court in India. The Federal Court was given exclusive original jurisdiction to decide disputes between the center and constituent units. The provision was made for filing of appeals from high courts to the federal court and from federal court to the Privy Council. The federal court also had jurisdiction to grant special leave to appeal to Privy Council, and for such appeals, a certificate of the High Court was essential. The Privy Council has acted as the highest appellate authority for all courts in India. In British India, it has played a very important role in shaping the present Indian legal system as well as judicial institution. So with this, I have completed the origin and establishment of Privy Council. In the next lecture, we are going to discuss the contribution of Privy Council in the development of Indian legal system. Thank you.